tort, you know, various forms of tort insurance. There's a whole range of ways in which you incur legal risk just by living your life that you can't avoid. And if the legal risk needs to be settled in a currency, that's not a tax in the most direct sense, but it is a sense of you're always and everywhere in the web of potentially needing to pay government money. And as long as that potentiality there, it's sort of like when they do Skinnerian behavioral conditioning tests and they don't press the button every time to shock the rat, but they press it enough times that the rat's scared every time that their finger gets close to the button. You know, you don't need to have the tax imposed every single day, you just need to have enough of a risk of a serious need that there'll be a demand. So I think you can take that idea of liability and go more broadly even just than a directly incurred liability. You could talk about in terms of property rights. Marx talks about primitive accumulation and how this was how certain, you know, communities that were not monetized, were not brought into capitalist accumulation, were brought into it, often kicking and screaming because the British Empire or someone did put a gun to their head and threatened to burn their house down unless they started earning money, and in that process made them unemployed and then employed and then brought them into the virtuous monetary circle. On the other question, one clarification, which is, I think, you know, one of the things that MMT talks about with its understanding of money as credit is you have to look at both sides of the equations. So with the central bank balance sheet, there was a massive expansion of central bank balance sheets in the US, for example, in Japan, for example, mostly involving the purchase of government securities. So what you had was an increase in the central bank's owning of securities and an increase in the amount of liabilities that they've created. Another way of saying that is, beforehand, there was $16 trillion or however many trillion dollars in treasury-issued money, and now there's $4 trillion less in treasury money and $4 trillion more in central bank money. So in terms of everybody else's lived experience of the world, there's roughly the same amount of government-issued assets as there were before QE. Even with private sector assets, with mortgage-backed securities and things where there is some private sector risk, they are socializing something, they are picking winners and losers in the socialist sense that those financial market practitioners seem to hate so much in theory. Even there, if you have a mortgage-backed security where there's a risk that it's going to fail or some amount of toxicity and you purchase it and therefore make it safe for whoever's wanting to offload it, you're not taking on the whole face value of the security at that risk. So, you know, even if it was 5% or 10% or even 30% of the risk of some of these securities, we're not talking about they purchased 10 trillion, therefore there's 10 trillion of new money. We have to think about it in terms of what assets were being replaced, what the qualitative shift was. Something went from being of a red hue to a green hue to a blue hue, and maybe blue is better than red on some features or something. So I don't think it's a matter of there being a run from government currencies. When you saw the Standard & Poor's rating agencies downgrade US debt a few years back, everybody ran two treasuries. Government money is still the safest money in town for smart money, big money investors. Now, how much you can earn speculating with cryptocurrencies, how much you want to hedge against particular governments with those currencies, fine. Reasonable minds can differ, in my opinion. I don't think most people who understand this stuff think that those cryptocurrencies are going to replace governments entirely. I think they can have a role as a space. I think they can have a role as a form of empowerment of a certain kind of techno-financial class that's different from other financial classes. And Brett, who's here today, has talked amazingly about the various cultures that exist within these spaces and their different interests. And something else that he said, which I am in furious agreement with, is I think whatever you think about the future of cryptocurrencies, they have really increased the imaginative space that the average person has access to think about money. I care about this stuff and live and breathe it. A few of my friends do. A lot of my friends don't, but the number of them that have come to me having read an article about cryptocurrency or Bitcoin and things that have started thinking about these things in a way that the average person would have been far more likely to do in 1890 or 1830. There were times when money was more of a in the public eye, more in the public attention, more in the public imagination, and I think this technological shift is net positive on that basis alone. I don't know what other form of propaganda of the deed or huge media event could have gotten millions and millions of people to care about what money is, how it works, how they could create it themselves. Not make it, but you know, there's that great line people used to say about Marx, if only he cared as much about making money as he did about understanding it. I think my little twist on that is only people cared as much about creating monetary systems as they did about about understanding monetary systems, they did about creating monetary systems for profit. So I would love it if all the people who are interested in the Bitcoin blockchain craze cared about everything beyond how to make a return in their immediate trading environment. But even beyond that, I think it's still a net positive. So I don't think people are abandoning the public sphere. I think what you're actually seeing now is an interesting moment where, on one hand, there's all this stuff about populism. You're hearing about populists on the left and populists on the right, and like, God forbid the populists on the left want to be associated with, you know, some of the people on the right, but then there's similar constituencies or similar anxieties they're trying to be tapped into or understood. But there's also this other layer, which is the sort of anarchist left and anarchist right. And I don't agree with a lot of people on the anarchist right about how money works and how property rights work, but I do see a totalitarian surveillance techno-state structure that's emerging, that the NSA and the CIA and MI6 on one hand, and Facebook and Twitter and Gmail on the other hand, are not, they're closer than they are apart on a lot of those considerations. And so what the cryptocurrency space is to me is not so much about we're all going to pack up our toys and go home, because the left-wing people want to make sure that people have food and healthcare and housing, and the right-wing people want to make sure that someone's protecting their property rights. So everybody comes running back to government eventually for whatever reason. And if you're a financier, you come back for a bailout and you screw everything up. But I do think that there is a new mode of power that is emerging in the financial space with this cryptocurrency movement. You know, there was a video of Cody Wilson, this anarchist right-wing dude, who, law student from Texas, who built the first 3D printed gun. He had his interview with the BBC, and the BBC said, "Don't you think this is immoral? You know, don't you think you're going to let, you know, people are going to die because of you?" And he said, "I'm not interested in the morality level. I'm sort of in this Nietzschean level. I'm changing the power relations. No one is ever going to be able to unprint or uncreate this software file that I've just created and shared it." So I think cryptocurrency is at a moment when the entire internet could have been taken away from people's grasp, has said, no, money is still part of the fight. This is still a part of the technological layer of society that needs to be able to be conceptually so small that you can still put it in your pocket somehow. Otherwise, we're going to be giving up a lot of freedom and a lot of control and things. And that's why I work with central bank-issued digital currencies, trying to push for anonymity and central bank-issued digital cash structures that preserve people's privacy and freedom and things. That's sort of the technological fight that I'm most interested in my professional.
No, but I guess, you know, forgive me, I don't want to take away from other people, but just underlying all of this, I think, gets back to Marta's question about just, you know, the nature of the state and how you view the state sort of depends, you know, determines how you come out on a lot of these issues. Because you can say, fine, it is indeed the public sector, however distorted it might be, or conversely, it is the NSA surveillance, et cetera, et cetera. And I want to be as off the grid as possible. So, you know, that I think, you know, reality is changing as we have this conversation. So. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, just one on that is just that I think from a legal perspective, it's there's state power, then there's legal power. And I did a talk at an MMT conference a while back. One of the first talks they invited me to give to the community, you know, it's nice to feel accepted, was from a state theory of money to a legal theory of money. And my point exactly there was, we feel a sense of Republican ownership over the idea of law in a different way than we do to the state. That's what I meant about people carrying pocket constitutions around. People talk about my rights, you know, people say, "I'm gonna see you in court, you know, see my lawyer." You know, that idea of law as something that you own as much as the courtroom owns, as much as the lawyer even owns, as much as Antonin Scalia owns, that's a very different mode of power than pure just public sector, private sector. And I think one of the things that we're trying to push as a research program is, what does it mean if we take taxes, drive money, and think of it as legal? What does it mean if we think of money as a contract and actually think of contract law? It's not simply enough just to say a contract is an agreement between two people. There is a whole ecosystem of legal institutions and issues that have evolved to make that as safe and human as possible. And I think not to valorize or romanticize the law as a mode of social change, but I think it is the both the weapon and the shield in this situation. It's civil liberties and it's discussions of privacy and things where the defense against that technological onslaught from the deep state, or whatever you want to call it, and from the the sort of tip of the spear of capitalist markets is going to come from. And so we need to be thinking about how to use those instrumentalities and not be allergic to any form of public, what might be considered public in some way. Anyone else?
I'd be curious to hear more about the kind of ideological tensions, if there are any, within the community.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned kind of offhand about the, you know, we've had MMT for military spending for however long. We don't have any problem printing money for military spending. I was just thinking that after the Republican tax bill passed, the economic editor at Breitbart wrote a piece about how actually the deficit doesn't matter.
Yeah, this is John Carney.
Yeah. And yeah, it was a little bit like provocative or whatever. And I don't know if he referenced MMT directly,
yeah,
but he kind of gestured in that direction. I'm just so, and when you mentioned different populisms, you could easily see a version of MMT satisfying that side of things. I'm curious about what your thoughts are.
Yeah, no, that's a really, really interesting and important point. I mean, there's a couple of things to me, which is, first of all, what I said at the beginning was, you know, MMT is what MMTs do. Law is what lawyers do. Economics is what economists do. Look how many MMTs there are advising Donald Trump or advising, you know, Donald Rumsfeld or anything. There's a reason why we're all on one side of the political spectrum. We might have differences and minute ideological things, but nobody is out there working with people who are trying to do crime. That's at least a guiding overall principle of the community. Now, their ideas, that's a different question, because on one level, what their ideas are about an accurate description of how the monetary system works. And short of creating a system of occult hermeneutics where you have to be a level 10 thetan to get access to these insights or something, you're going to be releasing this stuff to the public, which means multiple people are going to be able to read it and share it, and people you don't like are going to be able to learn. Unfortunately, even fascists get to learn physics, right? And so what we, or maybe they don't, maybe we keep the military secrets and don't let them learn physics. Okay. But the point is that the John Carney has been an iconoclast on the right for most of his life. The reason he was chosen as Breitbart economics editor is because he was out there pushing Trump as this sort of economic national populist at a time when all of his other Republican buddies weren't. So he kind of got credit for holding that flame. And it's that same nose for being a contrarian that got him to MMT ideas at a point when the right was freaking out about budgets and stuff. So he's almost the exception that proves the rule. Not to say that, you know, don't ever vote any John Carney policies. I'm not saying you like the guy. But I'm saying what he identified there was something that needed to be identified. And it, thank God, Bernie Sanders appointed Stephanie Kelton as a chief economic advisor and has got her a founding fellow of the Sanders Institute, and we have a job guarantee agenda being articulated there, and we have, thank God, there is a left now articulating this stuff in a different way, because if those ideas were left to the right, we would have been screwed. And you can see this historically. This isn't just about MMT. In the 1920s, Helmut Schacht in the Nazi Party pushed a policy of money printing spending to create public works, and you know, it was successful on its own face in the economics. And to pit that against progress is very dangerous. You know, what you're seeing a lot of centrist Democrats do right now is saying, this tax bill is bad for the budget. They're wrong. It doesn't matter. It's not good for them to take that argument, because then it puts them on the opposite side of the right understanding of how the budget works. If you are for the right understanding, you must be Donald Trump supporter. It shouldn't be John Carney making that argument. It should be us that's making that argument better. So to give an example of somebody who did that argument better, Sean Sebastian, who runs the Fed Up program at the Center for Popular Democracy, which organizes grassroots activism around the Federal Reserve, at that time was launching a campaign and counter-campaign saying, here's how we could use that $1.5 trillion in spending better.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't saying the tax cuts are bad, it's going to blow a hole in the deficit, none of that bullshit. Was saying, if $1.5 billion of spending is on the table, here's our wish list, right? We've got schools and healthcare and jobs and housing. They've got the military and tax cuts for the rich. Let's see which one wins. Rather than, no, you can't do that. It's making the budget worse. Ugh, nobody cares, right? That, or people care in a way that ends up biting them further down the road when Social Security gets cut to fix the budget or something, which is obviously what they say next and what Paul Ryan has said. So the ideas can be wielded a lot of different ways, the ones about the insides of how the system works. What we try to do is keep a control of that narrative and keep a control of that community, and by making sure that its leaders and there's a social valuation process of people coming into that space, it's always hard to work out in the margins how much you want to let people in and things who seem to be disagreeing with you on the very fundamental things and how much they're worth saving or how much they're worth trying to convert and things. But I think one aspect there is to look at who we're working with and who we're trying to help support, and to see that, to take the example of the basic income movement that Andres was talking about, we aren't entering into unholy alliances with Silicon Valley or, you know, the CEOs of the top five banks. You know, every now and again there might be an iconoclastic financier who's willing to speak up against his class or something, or her class, usually it is. But it's not like there's a sort of handout of capitulation to a layer of the power structure that is coming along with what we're doing. If there was a sort of there was a hand feeding the back pocket that was going on, I would hope that people would call it out. And people have called out Warren Mosler and said, oh, he's a banker, how could he ever have these interests? And he said, I want to jail more bankers than you do, probably, if we line them up, you know. And other people say these different things, like, and that's how I would say to think about it, is this is a living community. It's about how these ideas are being weaponized, who these people are putting their, you know, help and support for. And more broadly, that question of how you have open knowledge lead a movement. You know, if you hid it from the bad guys, you'd also be hiding it from the people in your own organization who you don't think deserve access to those ideas. And that's where you start running into governance issues and things.
Yeah, you briefly mentioned that it's not like money is infinite. Will you expand a little bit more about what are the constraints or the restrictions to the production of money? And related to that, it seems to me that there is like a national-based framework, and how do you deal with the fact that there is an international hierarchy of currencies, and it's not the same, the credibility and the capacity to issue money from, I don't know, the Venezuelan government and from the US, and how do you deal with that?
Yeah, they're both great questions. So on the first question about limiting principles. I think this is one of the first things that is often very scary when people come across this. It sounds like you're blowing the lid off. It's part of the imaginative space. So I think it's, you know, people talk about simplicity on the other side of complexity. We want to get back to scarcity or back to limiting principles in some way, but we want to do it on the other side of the understanding that infinity symbol at the monetary layer. So money is infinite. What it can buy isn't. And so, on the first step, when it comes to the idea of a job guarantee and full employment, what we're saying is, at the very least, we can stop wasting resources, right? I had a professor who used to say, the biggest waste, economic waste in the world is the wastage of human brains. People who could grow and could learn, could become something, who are not given the means to actualize and to be their best selves. And that idea is something that is about reducing scarcity. If we say there's been 8 million people who've been getting up and not going to work every day who would like to work, not just pumping a hand crank, but like to do something to actually improve the people around them, that's a huge amount of goodwill and positive outcomes that are not being done on a daily basis because we're just not setting up the monetary system properly. Beyond that, the next thing to think about is, yes, there can be a situation where you have a bottleneck of a good, you know, rare metals to go in an iPhone, or oil in the 1970s or something. Those issues are about particular industries, particular sectors, particular forms of goods. They can't be analyzed just abstractly from a monetary layer. I can't know just by looking at the amount of dollars I spent in the economy whether we're reaching a world bottleneck shortage. That requires industry-specific analysis. But the way that prices get formed isn't some mechanical market force. There are people who set prices in businesses. There are people who set prices in trade associations. There are people who set price regulations and who allow property rights to exist in intellectual property that would. So I would say that thinking of, and then even then, the prices that you include in the CPI, that include in your measure inflation, is also subjective. We don't look at, just to give an example, all of the asset prices that inflated over the last 10 years in financial markets as evidence of inflation. Inflation is if egg and milk and chicken go up, right? Asset price, you know, increases is when financial securities go up. Those different indexes of prices don't interact with each other when we think of inflation. So there isn't a single mechanical relationship between one stock of money and inflation rates. There can be ways that you can cause inflation, but they depend on the way that you set up markets. They depend on the ways that you set up the underlying structures of production. And so what I think MMT is trying to get to is, one, that's where we need to be talking about. We don't need to be talking about whether we've run out of money, whether we're printing too much. We certainly don't need to be thinking, for example, QE is pumping $1 trillion in that didn't have anything that was being pumped out on the other side. I'm not sort of saying you said that, I'm just saying a lot of people have this idea that QE printed trillions of dollars, printing is inherently inflationary, there's going to be inflation around the corner. Most people lost a lot of money. But that idea was really pervasive in some circles of even quite sophisticated financial macroeconomics. What we need to get to is a point where people say, oh, Greece wants to set up its own currency and to go on its own. Does it have a way to keep importing enough oil and medicine in those interim months? Does it have a financial correspondent banking network that can allow trade flows to maintain real terms of trade? Is it going to have enough foreign aid and support if those real terms of trade don't balance out its core goods? That's not a question of financing, right? Now, when it comes to, well, how much of our bucket list could we pay for before we start hitting inflation? You're right, it does matter. It matters if you're Mali, it matters if you're the United States. So again, what this framework brings us to is we can start having a conversation about sovereignty. We can have a taxonomy of sovereignty and a theory of monetary sovereignty. If you're in a position where you can maintain basic living standards and maintain basic conditions that are going to keep your populace from having a revolution tomorrow, with the kinds of terms of trade that you're able to sustain, you're probably pretty monetarily sovereign. Right? That might be true of America, might be true of Canada, might be true of Australia, might be true of Japan, I don't know how many other countries that's true of. But we can at least point to them and say that's different. So one thing that I was very upset about in 2012 was South American countries were moving towards a monetary union. They got so scared by what happened in Europe, they backed out and said, no, 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 not anytime soon. But a number of small countries with a population of a few million could have come together and formed a bloc that might have had a critical mass that would have had the kind of geopolitical productive sovereignty that would have reduced the reliance on foreign imports and exports, foreign imports in such a way that that reduced its sovereignty. So it allows you to have a theory of monetary sovereignty and working out who has it, who doesn't have it, how you might get more of it, who might be inherently constrained under their current structure. And then going off that, it allows you to have a conversation about the real kinds of inequalities going on right now. We can't have a conversation about financial exchange markets without talking about the military bases that the United States has around the world. You can't have a conversation about sovereignty in, you know, a small island country without talking about the geopolitics of the central banking system and when different classes or different countries get access to liquidity on an unsecured basis from other countries. So that power relationship becomes the meat and potatoes of the conversation. It doesn't fix those problems, but it at least points you to the right problem. And then on the underlying question of, we can at least always produce as much as we have people willing to produce. That's our scarcity reduction elimination conversation, is that at the very least we can stop wasting our own people. And ideally, we can stop wasting natural resources and things too once we shift our economy away from, you know, consumption of real resources towards things like consumption of services and things that we do for each other that don't have as high a carbon footprint or something. You know, I like to joke, you could have an entire economy built around massages if you wanted to. The numbers would still look good. You could post a profit. You could have financial investments. You could have franchises and things, and everyone's just giving massages. That's the only good in the economy. Now, what's the eco footprint of increasing GDP every year? Hands get tired. It's not much. So the eco footprint of the money system of nominal growth is not the same as the eco footprint of industrial capitalism, and we don't have to think of those as automatically the same.
I have a question. Rowan, can you tell us a little bit more about the stand from MMT about what should be the role of the state in the economy?
Yeah, well, so what I was trying to get at earlier was the sort of baseline, which is there are a lot of contentious things that even reasonable minds may differ about. If you've grown up being the beneficiary of a welfare program, you might have a very positive view of the state. If you've grown up being the victim of systemic exclusion and discrimination, you might be very skeptical of the worst abuses of the state. Both those could be legitimate perspectives in terms of your disposition. What MMT is trying to get at from the start is saying, what are the, before we even get to those things, what are the things that we can't avoid being a responsibility of the state? What are the things that we have to have conversations as a collective about? So you could talk about environment being a pretty obvious one. We can't keep talking about environment around the world as something that is independent of all of us, that we can enter into bilateral agreements about. Another one is privacy. We can't talk about information as something that exists in a purely bilateral, private sense. There's an ecological dimension to privacy. When somebody has every single person in this room's name and face, you're the other name and face in the room, right? They don't need yours, they just need to know that you're the odd one out. So information about social society starts at the collective level, and then you get individualized about these things. So there are certain things that have to be done at a collective level. Whether you call that the state or something else, it's not as big a deal to me. Then there are things that have to be done at a legal level. And again, that doesn't have to be the state either, but it has to be a legal system. Now, do you want to call contracts a state system? Well, a lot of people will call contracts the essence of private law. Two people coming together making a contract. But any lawyer will tell you, there's always a third party, which is the judicial system, that's enforcing and ratifying. Even if you never go to court with your contract, you're making that contract in the shadow of the courts with the knowledge that you could go to the court or that there'd be a risk that someone might take you to court. So that question of what is public and what is private gets dissolved a little bit when we start looking at some of these things, because a private corporation is an entity that has a legal business identity that has to have articles of incorporation that get ratified by a state secretary of state, that have to meet, you know, accounting and regulatory rules. If they hire people, they have to meet labor standards. You know, their property has to meet regulatory standards. There's a whole bunch of things that are not simply a priori private. That you couldn't be a corporation without limited liability. Limited liability is not something that exists in the state of nature. That's a subsidy that governments have given to corporations, saying if you create a corporation, you put on your corporate CEO hat, you lose $1 billion, you can walk away and keep your house. That's a bailout. That is a form of government subsidy for a certain kind of industry institution. So I don't know what this private thing is. I would say it exists independent or prior to the world of property rights and contracts and legal institutions. In that world, what we choose to call public and what we choose to call private, we can have a debate about that. What I would say is, what MMT puts the moral argument at the state for is unemployment. Unemployment is a creature of the state. That's how I would frame it. And money, in terms of public money, is a creature of the state. Which means if there isn't enough public money out there relative to how much there could and should be, or if there is too much unemployment relative to how much there could or should be, those responsibilities have to lie with the state that has the power to do something about it. In the same way as if a court made a decision that I didn't like, I would put the burden on the court. If the Supreme Court rules something unconstitutional, that is a problem you can blame the Supreme Court and say, change your ruling. Do something about it. So in the terms of unemployment and in terms of investment, the creation of enough money in circulation. That doesn't mean that other regions can't create money. I'm just saying that's the one who the final buck stops with. My personal view, healthcare, education, environmental, I can make a shopping list of what I think in terms of social services that should be written publicly. But in terms of what MMT is saying at the basic level, money and labor is the kind of thing.
All right. Thanks. Any other comments?
So, talked about, I guess, MMT as being
fundamentally immoral argument for jobs guarantee, for other policies that have social ends in mind. I'm just wondering, again, given the relationship between the so-called private and public spheres, the legal underpinnings of most institutions in our society and how those are blurred, I think, yeah, that that's complex, but at the same time, if we step back and look at, I guess the balance of interests or the way that power is skewed in our society, it seems there would have to be a very large institutional shift or some sort of large change in the way that things operate, in order to achieve, let's just say, this jobs guarantee program. I don't know, just for example, considering, in the so-called private sphere, profitability as something that would come in direct conflict with something from one perspective or another. So I guess my question is, what sort of change or institutional variables we really have to confront in order to make this set of policies or policy proposals more than just, well, it would be nice if people had jobs.
Yeah. No, also a great question. And this goes back to what I started with, which is, MMT starts as a set of insights about economics and then quickly gets into, well, how do we actually make it work? How do we implement it? So suddenly it's gone from being just a theory about money to a theory about social change. Embedded into MMT has to be the idea that this is a viable theory of change with this information, something is different, otherwise who the hell cares, right? And then once we get to that is, who do we include in that process? Who gets invited to the table to ask about what change we want? So it becomes a theory about organization and movement building and institutional dynamics. So, on that, one thing I'd say is the job guarantee, as Andres was talking about, is about transforming what we mean by work, but is by no means positing a world where that's the end of everything, we just work forever into the future. It's saying that as long as we want a certain standard of living, somebody has to do that work, we need a way of sharing that work responsibility, and people in general, while there's work to be done, want to participate. So it's a theory of participation. In terms of the institutional change that need to happen, the first thing I'd point out is, one of the ways in history that change has been able to be successfully leveraged from below is by exploiting divisions and weaknesses between the interests of people of a certain, otherwise homogenous class. So what you're seeing now, for example, in the cryptocurrency space, I would say is certain interests that are at tensions, and they'll resolve these tensions eventually if you give them enough time, between telecom and IT companies and banks. They have different business models, they have different interests, they have different expertises, and in many ways, they're finding themselves stepping on each other's turf in each other's spaces. Another thing that you're seeing is industrial capital and financial capital, in some ways, are becoming in opposition. There are some companies, people talk about GM becoming a bank and things, they're still not the big players in those spaces relative to, the actual banks or the hedge funds. And the hedge funds and the banks are making a lot of money right now, whereas a lot of industrial capital industries are not doing as well. So there is a sense after the global financial crisis that there was a rupture in a way that business was done, the way that certain interests were patting each other's backs, that has not been resolved. And Rosa Luxemburg said socialism or barbarism, we're sort of getting closer to that day by day. And so I think, If we don't have fascism and we don't have world war, we're going to have some things are going to give in a pretty big way soon. In terms of where MMT goes, partially it's trying to exploit those differences. So there are a lot of businesses that want more sales. They want more people with money in their pockets to go buy stuff. Those people aren't necessarily intrinsically pro-austerity. Other people that see ways to privatize and to substitute private investment for public investment things, they might be pro-austerity. Those interests can be exploited against each other. You also have social media and a mass populist movement in whole parts, different parts of the world that are toppling existing ways of doing politics and organizing. My organization provides educational and advice support to social movements. People involved with on-the-ground grassroots organizing, we try to give ideas and advice about how to do that better or do that in a way that's informed by these ideas or consistent with the broader strategy, But they're the ones doing the heavy lifting on the ground, organizing people and building political power on the streets. I think one of the things that's interesting about MMT's ideas is the job guarantee is a standalone idea, but the idea about how funding works is broadly applicable. You could talk to people who work in the art space, who work in the education space, who work in the law enforcement space, who work in the fire department, a whole range of different services, and say, you know, where are you guys struggling? And they'll say, all of our good ideas are told that we can't afford them. Budget cuts this, budget cuts that. We don't have enough money for extra, you know, overtime. We don't have money for improved infrastructure, for reviewing our, you know, inventory. That is a unifying feature. We worked with a group called the Debt Collective, who did a lot of stuff that you might have heard about, buying up private debt and forgiving it. They bought up medical debt, they bought up student debt at pennies on the dollar, and they made a big show of forgiving it. One of the things they talk about is, at the time that industrial capitalism was reaching its heyday, there was a large fraction of people that were in factories having similar working experiences. Today, people's work experiences are so varied, but 70% of people are in debt to one of five debtors, creditors. So your identity as a debtor is a far more unifying identity than your, or as someone who is not on the side of having financial capital, is far more unifying even than the idea of being members of a certain kind of labor class. And that is a potentially unifying political force. But I would say, you know, it's not that the world is going to have an MMT political party that says with the MMT party. It's that there's going to be a progressive party that's going to be informed by these ideas. And our theory of change is they'll be more effective at beating the current ghouls and ghosts in front of us, saying there's no alternative. We've run out of money. Government's the problem. Right? When that's the framework, this is a way to get past that. Like, I could say, I'm an anarchist. I hate the state. But I also acknowledge that the only way for people to earn money right now in a sustainable way is to get access to work. So giving people an interest, a personal individual right in having access to work is a form of empowering individuals against the state. Because otherwise, the state is keeping you in a state of unemployment. It's a bunch of bureaucrats on the Federal Reserve Board choosing to set an unemployment target, and if I happen to be part of the 3.5% of unemployed people, tough luck to me. I just got screwed out of a job by a government bureaucrat. I can make an anti-government case for a job guarantee as much as I can make a pro-government case, because it's about, you know, empowering individuals and things. So I think the internal strategy of MMT versus the strategy of broader progressives that is MMT infused, they're different, they work together, but a lot of it is responding to the moment, and a lot of it is responding to the technological capacity that we have today that we didn't have in prior eras when these fights happened. But even in the past, you had Keynesianism and those ideas that did change, you know, built a lot of institutions. You had various social movements, more liberal or socialist or whatever, or radical, that pushed them in different ways. But the last time we had a crisis of the scope of 2008, we did have a massive reimagining of all, unfortunately it took a world war in the middle, but we had a big reimagining of a lot of social institutions. Hopefully we can do that world war this time, right? So.
All right. Well, guys, with that we have to close the session.
David, just one thing.
Yes, sir.
I wonder if you and Rowan and maybe some others would be able to put together a bibliography of references about MMT and send it to like the Econ List, because I for one would be fascinated to pursue some of these things, and you know, just
send it to the Economist. You mean the magazine?
No. There's an internal Econ List here at the New School.
Or maybe we can send it to you, and you can help us to send it to the.
Well, some of the graduate students in economics would be better able than I am, since I'm not actually in it. But you guys know.
Yeah, I mean, we have a website with you know, videos and resources and things that we've put together as a starting point.
Okay.
I'm happy to give you my email. If there's any particular questions, I can send you particular links. But I've got talks up and things, but we put on over 50, 60 learning events that have bibliographies for each event. So
okay,
that's how I would.
That doesn't.
Yeah,
thank you.
ModernMoneyNetwork.org. Okay.
I think Stephanie told from Runaway, all these people are actually in the e-commerce, so I don't want to be sending everyone references about their own papers. Yeah, they are. Stephanie Galton is a former
Yeah,
she's definitely in the e-commerce, all the other ones.
Well, on behalf of the Public Urban Policy Doctoral Student Association, we thank you all for being here, Rowan. We thank you for the presentation. And we will have... We will have three more sessions this semester, so we will be circulating the flyers. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.